watching tonight's show on education and how it's working for Aboriginal people. You know, a news report came out in today's Globe and Mail. It says the First Nations Technical Institute, it's founded by the Tyendinega Mohawk community and council in 1995 with funding from the federal and provincial governments. Since then, that university has awarded degrees and college diplomas to more than 2,000 Aboriginal students. Now, the Indian Affairs Minister has slashed a previous commitment of funding by 66%. That cut is on top of a 25% cutback last fiscal year. Minister Chuck Strahl suggested that they should go after money from the private sector or alumni. Strahl also said that he sees post-secondary education is a provincial responsibility, and of course the provinces that fund the mainstream system disagree that they're responsible for a school that's on a reserve. Dennis, is this an issue of jurisdiction for you, or is there something else at play?
Well, it's partly the jurisdictional issue that's involved with it, the question of who does have responsibility for funding Aboriginal or Indian education in particular, and being on reserve. So, under the Constitution again, 9124, Indians and lands reserved for Indians. We are the only cultural community in Canada that by law have to go to school. And that's a decision of the minister. It's not a decision of the parent.
Oh, I always thought it was compulsory for everyone under 16.
No, it's a parental right. The parent, it's the right of the parent to make a decision as to where their child's going to be educated. What the test they have to meet within the provinces, provincial demands, is that they get a reasonable education. For Indians, we don't have the opportunity to make that decision. It's already in the Act, stated clearly in the Act, and acted upon by the Minister of Indian Affairs, that our child must go to school when they're 7 years old, and if they're until they're 16. There's a responsibility attached to that, i.e. funding. If they want to provide the schooling, then they also have the obligation to fund it. Unfortunately, this funding scheme doesn't deal with reality. It deals with what I call schooling in la-la land. Okay, how that works out in the Mainland is that if a status Indian were to go into a provincial school as a non-provincial resident, then the parent of that child then would be back charged upwards of $10,000 a year. But if that same child goes to an on-reserve school, they only get about $5,000 a year.
Yeah, you have that big discrepancy.
Absolutely. So now we're going to carry this into a post-secondary institution. And the model that they're throwing at us, i.e. the traditional university or college system, and saying, yeah, we're going to cut your funding, and you now have the option to go to alumni and the rest of your community out there. We don't have the dollars in our communities, and we don't have the alumni strength to support that kind of an institution. So because we've had a couple years of experience, they expect us to be in the same position that the traditional Queen's, the University of Ottawa, UT, Manitoba, etc., who've been in this business for 100 years are in, that they had produced a lot of graduates, their business people, their government people, etc., and a large alumni that they go to and say, give me $10. So every $10 adds up. But if we only produce 500 graduates so far, every $10 is going to add up too much.
Definitely not the same.